We changed the color of the logo to black, so now it's time to begin. Welcome to the Anvil. Thank you so much to everyone for being here, including those of you who are watching me via live stream. We're really happy to just have everybody together to have this discussion today. So all of your efforts in doing that is valuable, and we appreciate it. I'm Andrew Dickinson. I'm the Executive Director of Flyover Media. We are a cultural education nonprofit. We produce, support, and publish multimedia journalism on rural and underrepresented communities. We are one of the two organizations that's putting this event on. The Anvil is brought to you by Humanities Nebraska. They're one of our biggest funders. The only reason we could bring people in from Kansas and Oklahoma and all these great in-state panelists and speakers. So Humanities Nebraska is a statewide nonprofit organization that inspires and enriches personal and public life by offering opportunities to thoughtfully engage with history and culture, and we have additional funding from the Nebraska Cultural Endowment as well. So if you enjoy this type of programming, please consider giving to Humanities Nebraska with a contribution. Donations that they receive are matched by state and federal funds, so your support helps preserve our past and inform our future. I'd also like to thank the New Territory magazine. Without New Territory, Tina Casagrand, this wouldn't have happened today. So a huge thanks to them. They have a booth upstairs where you can check out their magazine. The New Territory is the magazine for the lower Midwest, and we are here, so I encourage you to support them in what they're doing by a subscription. So today, we're here to talk about the practice and consumption of journalism in rural communities. I want to tell you a little bit about myself first, though. So I grew up in a suburb of Kansas City, not a rural place. At 15, I wasn't exactly kicked out of my Catholic high school, but they really wanted me to leave. To this day, though, my mom says it's the best thing that ever happened to me. My very Catholic mom, which may be watching right now. It set me on the path to be right here today in front of you all, putting this conference together, doing journalism on rural places with a purpose. So I get kicked out. I transfer to Shawnee Mission North. I end up in J1, Journalism 1. It's the intro to journalism class at my high school. One of our first assignments was to give, we were given like a set of information and we had to give it back as an article, like a really basic assignment. And my teacher just put a little note on there urging me to join newspaper and yearbook, and so I did. A few years pass and I'm a senior. I've worked it out so that my schedule has me in the journalism room half of each day. I've got newspaper and yearbook and seminar and something else. I didn't know it then, but I was sort of realizing for the first time the power and my passion for working collaboratively with groups of people toward a common goal that we all really cared about. This is the first time I'd done something like that outside of a sporting team. So back in high school, amid my college search, I'm in the journalism room and the teacher says, the phone's for you, and it's a guy named Scott. And he tells me he's heard I'm looking at Drake and Mizzou and KU, and he might have some thoughts for me. He says, I'm a recruiter for the University of Nebraska School of Journalism, but I'm not gonna recruit you. And then he did. So I end up in Lincoln for college, really unwittingly. I'm here to study to be a reporter. I know no one. I don't even know who Tom Osborne is at the freshman convocation. And that's like a sin in the state of Nebraska. So guided by Scott, I go to the student paper, the Daily Nebraskan, and a beat is promised to me, the Committee for Fees Allocation beat, which a few days later turns out doesn't even exist until second semester. So I have no beat, I have no spot on the staff. They tell me that I can go join photo staff if I want, so I do. And I join the photo class after, bringing me to 21 hours. To get into that class, I showed my photo professor, Bruce Thorson, pictures I had taken the summer before while I learned to manually expose a camera. These were pictures of flowers, bees, fences, Coke bottles in the sand. Really shitty pictures. So I remember that semester I had 21 hours and I got like a 3.9. So that should tell you how like just weird and without a social life I was. Turns out there's a program at UNL that I had no idea about when I came here called the Global Eyewitness Program, and I'm accepted into it. And in May, I'm going to Kazakhstan. The next year, it's Kyrgyzstan, then India, Brazil, Ethiopia, the Dominican Republic, and Haiti. So what I'm saying is somehow getting kicked out of my Catholic high school led me to this and to this. Thank you, Bishop Miege. That's crazy, isn't it? Like, one thing led to another, to another, to another, and then my beat fell through. And now I'm at UNL, a state I know nothing about, a city I know nothing about, to study to be a photographer, not a writer, which leads me to work on a story about drug addiction in India. My fingers are sweaty. It's not switching. And a story about a boy in Ethiopia with 120-degree scoliosis. And now I've organized this conference, and it all just seems so far from anything that should have happened as I planned it. So I think it's important to realize the things that happen in our lives that lead us one way or another, and all of you have those things that have had you in these seats today too. So if I go back a little ways, when I was in Brazil, and this is a story that I've never really told too publicly before, I was jumped 2 days in a row, January 1st and January 2nd, 2013. A friend of mine saved my life the second time. She might be here a little bit later today. I still have the jeans that I was wearing that day, and you can see how they cut off my would-be wallet pocket. And you can see the blood from where my finger was cut, pushing a knife away from my chest. Thinking about those moments where I thought, shit, I'm gonna die, still throws me for a loop today. I was shook up. I really thought I was dead. And in those moments, I mostly just felt some weird sort of regret. So I knew after that happened, started to decompress it a little bit. Something that we all know, but we don't always feel is real, that time is limited. So on top of the ways of the world that the Global Eyewitness Program opens you up to as a student, which makes you feel really foolish about a lot of the ways that we live in America, I had that other thing opened up to me too in a really visceral way that stuck with me. So I knew whatever I did going forward had to be with some sort of purpose. So I want to step back even further now before Brazil and say that my interest, back to something that makes sense with this conference, my interest in rural America really began when I had an internship in Hardington, Nebraska, my first internship of college. It's a very different place from Sao Paulo. So I was born in 1991, so I remember the beginning of cell phones and dial-up internet and you've got mail, but most of my life has been spent connected. So for me at the time, going from Kansas City to Lincoln and then to Hardington was not a simple, easy adjustment. On top of that, I had no internet when I was in Hardington, and except for in one corner of town by a cornfield, I had no cell phone service. So I was a 19-year-old who had to spend a few months without great communication with my friends or family, and that was new. On top of that, I was shy. I was really shy and very inexperienced at the getting into the community part of journalism. So I spent pretty much all of that summer either alone or working. So to be honest, I remember a lot of sad loneliness during that summer, but also a lot of peace. I would get in my car once the sun went down, and I would just drive around, amazed by the stars and the space, and I would feel better. So I guess I both hated and loved the isolation. But what I found there was an opportunity to put aside personal relationships and just focus on becoming a photographer. I have so many memorable photographic experiences from that summer because of that. Afterward, I also did an internship at the Omaha World Herald and at Zuma Press, a wire service in Southern California. But ever since Hardington, there was always kind of a nagging in the back of my mind. I wanted to go back and live in a small town again, not as the shy 19-year-old. And after Brazil, I knew that whatever I did going forward in my life, I wanted to have some sort of purpose behind it. So we went to Valentine. And Valentine welcomed us with open arms. We reported for a summer on a project called Fly Over Me Valentine, backed by the belief that we would tell stories better if we had the time to invest ourselves in the community. We made some really incredible friendships. My cat, Georgia, who many of you know, is named after our neighbor the first summer, George. Ed, who was killed in July 2015, would stop by our house daily with trinkets he'd picked up at garage and estate sales. He'd leave us voicemails in Japanese, and he'd read our palms for a nickel at the corner bar. We'd go set off fireworks on a Main Street front yard after the demolition derby on the 4th of July. And then we'd go walk a few blocks to another friend's house and do more of the same. So we were there doing stories, yeah, but we were also just there as humans living in the community. I mean, look at us. Look at me. I have to say that we were not financially smart. We all put our own money into this after our hilariously off Kickstarter budget ran out very quickly. So I'm not saying I expect anyone or everyone to be able to just go and do something like this. We all had debt because of it. But none of us would take it back. We were a team who all believed that journalism could be doing better than it was doing, and that rural places deserve better coverage. The Valentine group is a lot like the group of people in this room today. We know we can do better. We're here because there's clearly an issue between rural America and journalism. Maybe you or I can't say that we know exactly what the problem is or what the solutions are, but I know that there's a group of people here who will work toward those solutions. And we can form connections and we can work together. So I want everyone to leave today feeling inspired to get out and use your talents and abilities to build bridges between people. And I think that if I can say anything, you should get out in the field, spend some time standing in cow shit, getting to know your subjects, and telling their stories. So with that, I'll stop. That's all you have to hear from me today. And I'd like to introduce your first speaker. We're really happy just to have an amazing group of people that are going to be here talking to and with you today. So first up, we have Matthew Hansen. He's born and raised Nebraskan from Red Cloud. He's a Metro columnist for the Omaha World Herald and puts out two or three columns a week on Omaha and Nebraska. He was named the 2015 Great Plains Writer of the Year. And just the other day was awarded he won the Sorensen Award for his reporting on Goodwill Omaha. He's someone who's long been an inspiration to me, a truly kind and caring man. So I'm proud to have him here today, and please join me in welcoming Matthew Hansen.
All right?
Yeah. All right.
So this is Seneca, Nebraska, or at least it used to be. I came to Seneca in 2014, lured there by a story that seemed too ridiculous to be true. The town pictured here had actually voted itself out of existence. A town had voted to become a non-town. My name is Matthew Hansen, and I'm a Metro columnist at the Omaha World Herald, which means that by definition, my job is supposed to be writing columns involving people, places, and things inside the metro area of Omaha, Nebraska. But since I got the job, I've stretched the boundaries of the metro area a little bit to include places like Seneca, which is probably not technically in the greater Omaha metro area. The actual story when I got to Seneca was so much more fascinating than I could have even imagined. Here's the story. Because of a dispute involving some mistreated horses, the village board had tried to bar some livestock from living inside the city limits. After a whole lot of fighting, a petition had circulated to dissolve the town, which, by the way, is in the Sand Hills, north of North Platte, south of Valentine. The petition got enough signatures on it to get the issue on the ballot, and on election day, May 2014, the residents of Seneca drove to nearby Thedford and voted by a vote of 17 to 16 to end this place that had existed since 1888. The town's village board was dissolved. They chose to give up local control in favor of county, state, and federal control. The equipment the village used to plow its streets and mow its ditches was taken. The street lights went dark. The water was turned off in the city park, and the community center, which is right here, was auctioned off. After the vote, both sides were still furious. Here's a section from the column that I wrote about Seneca. Residents have stopped speaking to each other, which isn't easy in a town that covers only 1/8 of a mile. When they pass each other in pickup trucks, they do not wave. When they're amongst like-minded friends and neighbors, they throw around accusations that would make the most hard-edged DC operative squirm. While in Seneca, I heard people on both sides say the following things about their neighbors: drug addict, drug dealer, welfare queen, verbally abusive, physically abusive, sexually abusive, creep, jerk, and much, much worse. The acrimony fogs everything, making it hard to see what Seneca once had and what it lost. It makes it hard to see that even if Seneca residents figure out how to pay for their own streetlights and the county does a good job of plowing the roads, they may still lose something. Maybe they already have. This town used to be a place that banded together and built something. Now this town is in danger of being the place that butchered off its collective nose to spite its collective face. It reminds me of a miniaturized version of Congress. It reminds me of the worst of modern day America, a place fueled by fury, where winning an empty argument always trumps the harder labor of searching for common ground. It reminds me that when we do this, we do lose something less tangible, yet still every bit as important as any streetlight or park or community center. I think the views of the in Seneca crowd were best expressed by a woman I interviewed and got to know a little bit named Terry Hartman. Terry was a waitress in town who lost her job and believed that she lost her job because the owner of the restaurant was in the Keep Seneca crowd. Here's a quote from Terry. "We just don't want people telling us what to do," says Terry Hartman, a Seneca resident who grew up here, graduated from high school here, and now lives with her mother in town. "We just want to be left alone." So that's a small town Nebraska story, and one I think is important. It's important because it tells us something about modern day America, for sure, but it's also important because it blows up a few stereotypes about this particular small town in Nebraska. I did not find the people of Seneca to be friendly. They were not neighborly. Many of them seem angry and in search of something to be angry about. This isn't the small town of a Norman Rockwell painting or the myth of a small town that politicians like to hold up as the real America. Instead, this is a real place, a troubled place. The first thing we miss when we miss small town Nebraska is reality. Myth-making is a lot easier when you don't know that places like Seneca actually exist. So this is Ord, Nebraska, located about 2 hours east of Seneca, actually on Highway 91. I went to Ord a couple weeks ago for a project that my wife Sarah, who's the World Herald foods critic, and I are working on. That project is essentially our version of a travel guide, except way funkier and way weirder than any travel guides we own. It's called The Better Half, and it's currently an occasional newspaper series in the World Herald that will be turned into a book late this year. We personally think of it as our little love letters to Nebraska, the hidden restaurants, places to stay, things to do, and neat people that you can meet across the state. And so I went to Ord to write about Scratchtown Brewery, which, by the way, makes maybe the best beer in the state of Nebraska. No offense to our sponsors today, Plowshare. They also make great beer. And Scratchtown is a great story. It's three guys, one of them pictured here. He's a former Omaha Chamber of Commerce exec. His two co-owners are an Omaha banker who got laid off during the financial crisis and a small town electrician. They all moved to Ord at various points, and they eventually started this place that a lot of locals said would never work. There's no Bush Light on tap. There's no jukebox. There's no food. There's no Crown Royal. And there's no Jim Beam. So, in other words, there's none of the trappings of a traditional small town bar, just scratch town beer. But when I went to Ord and talked to the Scratchtown guys, I started to realize that this was more than a story about local beer. And so I started talking to other people, local politicians, business owners, lawyers. The story became a story about Ord itself. Here's an excerpt from this column. That is like five spots too far ahead. In the 80s, the American farm crisis smacked Ord hard. Nobody was building, so the lumber yard closed. So did two hardware stores. People had less money for food, so the bakery closed, as did two grocery stores, as did almost every mom-and-pop restaurant in town. With corn prices spiraling ever lower and no end in sight, many longtime Ord families picked up and moved. Texas, Arizona, California. The only real local philanthropy came in the form of college scholarships, so the area's high school students could leave home and likely never return. Quote, "We were helping kids escape," says Bob Stoll, a veteran lawyer in town. The mid-80s through the 90s were a period of very, very low hope. And then things started to change. It began with an anonymous $1.2 million donation to the county, with a vague directive to improve the area. Stoll and others created the Valley County Economic Development Board, filled it with city leaders, and hired a dynamic 23-year-old named Beth Ann Coons to run this new organization. In 2001, the new board put out a survey question. Would Ord residents support a city sales tax for economic development in the area? Most of the residents surveyed had the same answer, no. And yet Stoll and other city leaders followed that survey result with a serious campaign, giving nearly three dozen presentations and hosting three public community meetings. Late that year, the town voted, and the ballot measure to add a 1% local sales tax passed with 74% of the vote. That, Stoll says, began everything. So here's what happened next. Ord used a donated building and some of this new economic development money to attract a call center that brought 100 jobs. They pursued and won a $50 million ethanol plant, a $9 million corn oil factory, a $16 million distiller grain operation, and several offshoot trucking businesses. And then after that, they actually lured an international company that builds parts for underwater cables. I want you guys to think about that for a minute. There's a manufacturing company that helps build cables that stretch underneath the oceans. That company is located on the outskirts of Ord, Nebraska, in the center of the most landlocked state in the country. It isn't just business either. Ord used a combination of sales tax money and federal grants to renovate the downtown, part of which you can see right here. It's the sort of thing that brings in a few tourists, and I think more importantly, really amps up the pride that the residents feel in their place. And Ord leaders did something even bigger, I think, than renovations or business recruitment. They partnered with the Nebraska Community Foundation on a project to teach Ord residents, both adults and children, how to be better leaders and better entrepreneurs. Here's what that looks like today. The Ord area supports a four-year leadership academy where local adults learn how to better impact their community. The school system has a mandatory eighth grade class on leadership and elective classes for high school students who want to start their own businesses. There's a summer entrepreneurship camp for teenagers and an annual event where the kids present their business plans to the public. Okay, three numbers that I think define Ord in 2017. Number one, 70% of Ord High School students say in an annual survey that they want to return to Ord after college graduation. A decade ago, that same survey showed that 30% of Ord high schoolers wanted to return home. Number two, the total number of young adults living in Ord spiked by 53% between the years 2000 and 2010. Number three, Ord Public Schools boasts 626 students this year. That's a spike of roughly 12% since 2012. And even better, public and private enrollment figures show that this year's Ord area kindergarten class is the largest in the past decade. Here's Stoll again. None of this happened by accident. This success is feeding on the success. And then there's no reason it has to end anytime soon. So that is also a small town story, and also one that I think is important, and also one that blows up a lot of stereotypes about Nebraska small towns. Small towns hate taxes, right? And yet Ord mounted a campaign to raise its local sales tax, and city leaders credit that as the single biggest move that sparked the town's turnaround. Small towns are passive, right? And yet Ord aggressively recruited companies and partners with outside organizations to improve the lives of their citizens aged 80 and aged 8. Small towns are dying, right? Well, before you believe that, you should go to Scratchtown Brewery on a Friday or Saturday night. I have, a couple times actually. The place is packed. It's packed with people in their 20s and 30s, many of them the young professionals that every single city and town and village in the country lusts after. Three of these young professionals own the place. And you also find visitors from Kearney and Grand Island and even Omaha and Kansas City and Denver. They come for the beer. But I guarantee you they look around can see that this story is about way more than beer. This is the man at the center of the third and final small Nebraska town I want to talk about today. That's actually a lie. I'm going to talk about four, but this is the third. I want to talk about him because as I thought about my speech title, What We Miss When We Miss Small Town Nebraska, I kept picturing his face. I think the easiest way to tell you the story of John Magan and why he matters is to read you the top of a column I wrote about him in 2015. Dateline Macy, Nebraska. Step inside the band room here, squeeze your eyes shut, and for a moment let your ears and everything you think you know about the world lead you astray. Two, three, four, booms a voice with the slightest hint of an Irish accent. Clarinets bleat, trumpets toot, saxophones honk. It sounds familiar, sounds timeless, sounds, wait, is that Beethoven's Ninth Symphony? It's a little squeaky, sure, a little slow, but not bad either. Probably seventh graders, yours tell you, getting their Ludwig on at a suburban middle school where students shell out hundreds of dollars for their own instruments and take private lessons and practice diligently at home. Okay, open your eyes now. Open your eyes as they continue to play the ninth and try to reconcile what you know with what you see. These are young kids, fourth graders, Native American kids, mostly members of the Omaha tribe, poor kids, some of the poorest residents of the poorest county in the state of Nebraska. They wear hand-me-down clothes and blow on ancient battered instruments they do not own and just learn to play this year. And yet, together, they are producing something that sounds suspiciously like music. Then the man standing at the front waves his hand like he's a conductor, and you hear a noise that would shock teachers and parents from Seattle to Savannah. Silence. These fourth graders at the Omaha Nation Public School stop playing Beethoven, silently sit ramrod straight in their chairs, and await instruction from the man at the front of the room, a man born in Dublin, raised in Queens, and then delivered to this remote northeast Nebraska Indian reservation when LBJ was president. John Magan half jogs to the second row of chairs and stops in front of a shy trumpet player. Your counting was right there, bud, he says in a staccato burst as he gives the boy a thumbs up. He smiles. It's good to get the right notes, too, you know, always helps. The wiry 69-year-old with the funny accent has taught them how to count music, read notes, and play them, just as he taught their parents and grandparents, just as he taught an actor who starred in Dances with Wolves and the tribe's current chairman. Just as he teaches countless pupils who struggle mightily to follow the advice written on a giant banner hanging on the band room wall. Believe in yourself, the banner says. He has taken them to Lincoln to play at the state capitol and to New York City into dozens of band competitions where they competed on absurdly uneven playing fields and yet somehow walked away with another plaque they hung on the band room wall. He's the founder of the school's own TV channel, the founder of an after-school printing program, a repairer of instruments, a repairer of young, fragile lives, an amateur psychologist, a self-taught philosopher, and a hustler if there ever was one, says the school's high school principal, who also calls him part of my family. He is the PA announcer at every home football game. He plays taps at every military funeral. Five children on this reservation are named either John to honor him or Emma to honor his late wife. Inside this classroom, he asks that they call him Mr. Mangan. After school, they call him another name, Grandpa. He's teaching the fifth graders now on a recent Friday, leading them in a rendition of Wipeout, which comes complete with a rousing drum solo from a 10-year-old named Alonzo. Good, not bad, good, Mangan yells after he halts the sound with another wave of his hand. After they're done playing for the day, a clarinet player walks to the front of the room and says something to him in a voice so soft that only he can hear the question. Why am I leaving? He bellows. Because I have been here 47 years, girl. I gotta watch the grass grow. Then the bell rings and the clarinet player and the rest of the students pack up their instruments and leave. It is John Magan's second to last Friday as a music teacher. He pours himself a watery coffee and pulls a pack of cheap cigarettes out of his breast pocket and tries to pretend that the clarinet player has not just cracked his heart wide open. So that's the beginning of a long profile I did about longtime music teacher of Macy, Nebraska, John Mangan. When I first heard about him, I did Google searches, LexisNexis searches to see how many newspaper profiles or magazine profiles I could find. Now keep in mind, this is an Irishman by way of Queens who landed in Macy, supposed to stay for 2 years, instead stayed for 47 years, during which he grew the most remarkable school band program you will ever find anywhere. And that was only one of about two dozen remarkable things that he did for Macy and Macy did for him. When I did those Google searches and LexisNexis searches, how many profiles of John Mangan do you think I found? None. Now, consider for a moment if we took John Mangan and we transplanted him back to, say, Queens, where he worked at a poor school there and did the exact same thing he did on the Omaha Indian Reservation. How many good stories do you think would have been written about this guy in 47 years? Dozens? Hundreds? Would he have made it on to 60 Minutes? Would someone have written a screenplay like Mr. Holland's Opus, except better? Would Richard Dreyfuss have lost weight to play John Mangan? Except he's in Nebraska, in the middle of nowhere, and none of the 10,000 fantastic writers who live in Brooklyn or the 10,000 fantastic writers who live in Hollywood have ever heard of this guy. He was just waiting there for me, like a journalistic gift from God. So what do we miss when we miss small town Nebraska? Well, we miss a lot. We miss amazing stories about people who deserve to be written about and read about. Just in the past few years, because I happen to live where I do and have the job that I do, I found the following three stories. This guy is a mysterious prohibition agent who, as you can tell, really liked to dress up. He went by the name Richard Hart. That's how people in Homer, Nebraska knew him. A couple decades after he got there, it was revealed to everyone, including his wife and children, that his real name was Vincenzo Capone, and he was Al Capone's oldest brother. I found a story about a reclusive political donor. In fact, a man who gave one of the largest donations in the history of Nebraska politics to a presidential candidate. And the guy turned out to be an heir to an Indiana farm plow fortune who lives in, of all places, tiny Arthur, Nebraska. He's a recluse, and one of the few things that I could get people in the town to talk about, because he seems to wield a lot of weird power in Arthur, Nebraska, was that there's this gravestone on the outskirts of town, and they used to have a town dog named Radar who would do things like go into the bar and they would feed it beer. And shockingly, the dog got sick. At some point, And so when he died, this guy paid for this gravestone and made sure to include that quote from Kirk on there. There's also this guy, who's an 85-year-old doctor who nearly went to federal prison because he refused again and again to stop growing asparagus in a ditch on a wildlife refuge. Here's a quote from a law enforcement official in that story. "There's not a whole lot of things that make sense in this case, to be honest with you," the officer said. "This right here is probably one of the most bizarre things I have ever been involved in. Here's what is really bizarre to me. I just listed three great stories. There are 3,000 others just as great out there in small town Nebraska right now, waiting for someone to find them. I'm biased, but there are at least 30 good stories in this last town I want to mention, my hometown, Red Cloud. By the way, I just realized that I'm wearing the same coat in the photo there. It really shows how extensive my wardrobe is. I want to mention Red Cloud because it's a giant reason why I seek out stories from all across this state. To give you one example, yesterday I could have found a column by driving 10 minutes down Dodge Street or simply walking a few blocks over to City Hall. Instead, I drove 3.5 hours to Cozad, did a 90-minute interview, and drove the 3.5 hours home. I'm pretty sure I did that because way back in the late 90s, I cruised Red Cloud's deserted Main Street on Friday nights that lasted forever. I drank Busch Light while sitting on the tailgate of a pickup truck next to a bonfire. I went to the Methodist Church on Sundays, said hello to all my grandparents' friends, and struggled to stay awake during the sermon. I went to the small town beauty shop to get my bowl cut, and of course that beauty shop happened to be run by my dad's cousin. I started on the football team, for Christ's sakes. Look at me. That is the most small town thing you can imagine. So I understand small towns, and it's because I'm from one, because I will always be of one, no matter where I go. But I wanted to mention Red Cloud just briefly for another reason. As many of you probably know, if you were awake during 10th grade English, Red Cloud is the home of novelist Willa Cather. And you can actually see it in this photo. They hadn't really started construction yet, but right here past my head, they had started construction on something called the Willa Cather Center, which is a historically preserved block on Main Street. It's opening in a couple months. It hosts archives, retail space, three apartments, a new library, places for academics, et cetera, et cetera. It took years to raise the $7 million necessary to build this, and like I said, it's opening in a couple months. Next year, in my hometown, the Valley Child Development Center will open. After years of no quality childcare and a $4 million fundraising effort, we're going to open an affordable, high quality child development center that just may end up being the model for small town America. So I'm the nephew of the Cather board member who helped to start this fundraising effort for the Moonblock project. I'm the son of two parents deeply involved in the Child Development Center. I'm the spouse of a Cather board member there on the left. And yet, not even I can believe that this is all really happening in my hometown. It's mind-blowing. It's inspirational. It's a great story. Red Cloud isn't Ord, and it isn't Seneca either. It's somewhere in between, and that crossroads, progress or decay, life or death, is at the very core of what makes great journalism. So what do we miss when we miss small town Nebraska? We miss an understanding of what makes Seneca or Ord or Macy tick. We miss what places like Ord and Seneca and Macy and Red Cloud tell us about ourselves, about each other, about the world. And when we fail to go to small town Nebraska, we allow those stubborn stereotypes to exist in place of actual specific stories. Nebraska nice? Not always. Small town Nebraska is dying? Not necessarily. And the worst one of all, nothing interesting ever happens in Nebraska. Please excuse my language when I say, respectfully, bullshit. Thanks, guys. Thank you.
about 10 minutes we could use for some Q&A, Matthew, if that's all right with you.
Yeah, let's do it.
Yeah, so I'll bring the microphone around to anyone that has any questions in the room. Who wants to get us started? All right, thank you.
Hi, great speech. Thanks for being here today.
Thanks.
I'm really curious how you can source these stories. So Seneca sounds like it's very far away from where you're based. How do you have, you know, these little feelers all throughout Nebraska, and how do you hear these stories?
I mean, it depends based on the story. In the case of Seneca, somebody from the town emailed me and basically alerted me to this thing that was going on in the town. I kind of followed it for a while. I mean, there was a little coverage of the sort of the vote, for example. So I was just reading what little I could find in newspapers, including a little bit in the World Herald. But I really wanted to go out there and you know, sort of see for myself what the, because you could tell, I mean, I could tell just from reading the little news briefs that there was a much bigger story probably at play here. And when I went out there, I realized that there was. But yeah, it really depends on the situation. I mean, the World Herald has a pretty long history of writing stories about small town Nebraska, pulled back from that quite a bit because of the realities of newspaper journalism. But we still have people there who really care about small towns and try to write about them whenever he can. Paul Hamill is one of them. He used to cover statewide and covers the state capitol now, but still does a lot of small town stories. And the guy over here, Joe Dugan, is another. So we all sort of help each other too. I mean, I've called Paul on a lot of, you know, when I hear something about a small town, I'll call him and he'll often know a person in that town.
All right, we got another one for you over here.
Hi there, thank you for that. That was wonderful.
Sure.
I don't know how specific you can get for this question or how many details you have. It probably depends on your, technology that the Omaha World Herald has, but what's the readership like, or how is the reception of these articles when you write such specific stories about Nebraskans in these small towns?
It's almost like I planted that question, because I was thinking about this a couple hours ago. I almost put it in the talk. The crazy thing about all these stories that I'm talking about is they're some of the most read things that I've ever written online. You know, the whole idea that for an Omaha audience, you have to only write Omaha stories, it is crazy. And it's proven again and again by stories like this. A lot of people who live in Omaha are from small towns, first of all. And we just care about good stories. I don't know, you know, there's something I think exotic sometimes to people about small town Nebraska, which exotic and small town Nebraska are not often used together in a sentence. But you know, there's something alluring to people about stories like this. I mean, I can't think of, we do have sort of online counts of how these stories do, and I can't think of any numbers, but the most recent two that I mentioned are the Ord one and the Richard Hart one. The Richard Hart one got, I haven't looked since the first couple days, but in the first couple days it got something like 50,000 hits online, which is a good number for the World Herald. I mean, that's kind of, outside of Nebraska football stories, that's a really big story for us.
All right, we've got time for one more. Bring it back here.
Thanks for being here. I'd like to hear in a little more detail about the response and perception of you as a journalist in these communities before and after these stories are worked on and published.
Well, and again, totally depends on the story. The people of Homer were not mad about Richard Hart. They really liked the fact that I came there and talked to them about this long ago story about Al Capone's long lost brother. The people of Seneca were not as excited. I think, I don't know, it's weird. I've done a lot of small town stories that are people in the town don't necessarily all want me to tell the story, but I've never really run into a situation where I can't write the story or a really bad situation after. And I don't really know why that is. I mean, I do drop in, parachute into these places, right? It's not like I wasn't doing the flyover Valentine thing where I was in Seneca for a long time. I was there for 2 days. So I do have a little bit of a disadvantage there in gaining trust, but I don't know. I mean, part of it is probably the World Herald imprint. Part of it is the fact that I can immediately tell people I'm from a small town, which I use to full advantage whenever possible in these stories. And part of it, I think they can probably just tell that I really do care, that I want to tell these stories to the best of my ability. That sounds corny, but I mean, I think that showing people that you have passionate about what's going on with them is always the best way to get people to open up and to trust you in a short period of time.
Let's give it up for Matthew Hansen one more time. We're going to take about a 10-minute break. We'll get started back at 2, and we will enter the panel section of the day. So, thanks.